Capstan Lever Logic for slow, bulky and fun computers, or at least parts thereof. In this video, I introduce a new way to construct and connect mechanical logic gates. I call it Capstan Lever Logic, or short CLL. The capstan plays the role of the transistor in electronic logic circuits. The capstan amplifies the output force. Any output is thus able to drive several inputs. The levers realize the logical function. Outputs and inputs are connected by strings. This allows as much flexibility as electrical wiring. Inputs are usually pulled up to 1 by a weight. In order to set them to 0, one must actively pull them down. Let us look at an inverter buffer first. The lever is pulled to 1 by a weight of 15 grams. You have to exert a force of more than 15 grams to pull it down to 0. But the 15 grams do not just pull at the lever. The orange string is clamped to the black string and wound twice around the rotating drum. This way, the force of 15 grams is amplified by a factor of about 20 to 30. The 15 grams on the left side can easily lift the 150 grams on the right side. The mechanism acts as an inverter. If you pull the lever, the orange string is released. If you release the lever, the weight can pull 10 or even more inputs down to 0. In terms of electronic TTL logic, we say that this inverter gate has a fan in of 1 and a fan out of 10. Next, let us look at a NAND gate. We have two input levers A and B and one output lever Z. The output lever is 1 if and only if both inputs A and B are 1. If one pulls A or B to 0, Z is forced to go to 0 as well. Thus, Z is equal to A and B. The logical state of Z is inverted by the weight and buffered by the capstan. On the orange output string, we hence have not A and B, that is A NAND B. Here we see something more complex, a half adder made from 3 NAND gates and 2 inverters. We have 2 inputs A and B and 2 significant outputs S and C that display the sum of the 2 input bits. 0 plus 0 is 0, 0. 0 plus 1 is 0, 1. 1 plus 0 is 0, 1. 1 plus 1 is 1, 0. Logically, the carry C is just A and B. In order to switch inputs or further gates, you would not use this unbuffered output C directly, but the doubly inverted and buffered output. The output S is A XOR B. That is, S is 1 if and only if either A or B is 1. The left input of the right gate is fed with A NAND B. The input A is inverted, buffered, and fed into this input. Similarly, The input B is inverted, buffered, and fed into this input. This output is therefore not B and not A, and the inverted signal of this is simply A or B. This is fed into the right input of the right gate. The output S on the right hence is A NAND B and A OR B, which is A X OR B. Note that this output is again unbuffered. You can obtain the inverted and buffered signal A equivalent B from here, but you would need one additional inverter to get a buffered A X OR B signal. We now come to the simplest form of computer memory, an R-bar S-bar flip-flop. This flip-flop consists of two NAND gates. The output Q1 of the left gate is connected to the left input of the right gate. The output Q2 of the right gate is connected to the right input of the left gate. Look at the output Q1. We can set it by pulling S bar to 0. It will remain in this state until we pull R bar to 0. Then it will keep its state until S bar is pulled to 0 again. The flip-flop hence stores one bit of information. This bit can be set and reset. This is why it is called set-reset flip-flop, or briefly R-bar S-bar flip-flop. How does this flip-flop work? If one of the inputs of a NAND gate is 0, the output is 1, no matter what happens on the other input. Therefore, Q1 becomes or stays 1 if S is pulled to 0, and Q2 becomes or stays 1 if R bar is pulled to 0. If one of the inputs of a NAND gate is 1, the gate acts as an inverter and buffer. Hence, when both inputs S bar and R bar are 1, the signal goes in a circle through two inverters and buffers. It hence keeps its state. What happens if you put both inputs S bar and R bar to 0? Of course, both inputs Q1 and Q2 become or stay 1. The following state is a question of whether you release S bar or R bar first. The outcome might be difficult to predict if you release them almost simultaneously. At the end of this video, I would like to make two remarks. In the 80s and 90s, I loved to build circuits like this with electronic logic ICs. With CLL, I tried to mimic electronic logic mechanically as much as perhaps possible. Another source of inspiration was an April hoax by the late A K Dewdney in the Scientific American for 1988. The gates sketched in this article were not functional. It took me some 35 years to figure that capstans and levers are the key to make these seemingly foolish ideas work. So much for now. There will be certainly more videos about CLL in the next weeks. I hope you will join me again. Thanks for watching.